The following is a class on the Bhagavad Gita as it is, second chapter, text number 7, by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada, recorded March 1966 in New York.
Now, Arjuna is perplexed. He is perplexed in the matter whether to fight or not to fight. That was his perplexity. After seeing his relatives in front of him with whom he was to fight, he was perplexed. And there was some argument also with Krishna. Krishna, of course, did not encourage. Now, here is a point that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. Krishna, although he is present there with Supreme Personality of Godhead, but still he did not encourage him. From worldly point of view, when somebody says that, I don't want to fight with my friend or my relative, better let them enjoy, I shall forgo my claim. From worldly point of view, this is a very gentlemanly behavior. The one is forgoing his claim and for the matter of his relative or friend. But Krishna is not encouraging that proposal. We have to mark it. Krishna is not encouraging. Krishna is rather inducing Arjuna that it is not a very good proposal, it is not befitting your position. You belong to the Aryan family, you belong to the Kshatriya royal family, and you are denying to fight. No, this is not good. And I am your friend. I have taken the responsibility of your chariot driver, and if you do not fight, what people will say? So he is not encouraging. Just see. Now here is a good proposal from the worldly point of view that Arjuna does not want to fight. And Krishna is not encouraging. Now what is the point? Somebody may say that Krishna, the Supreme Personality of Godhead, why he is encouraging in the matter of fight? The people at the present moment, when there is a question of war, people want to stop that war. At the present moment, the movement is going on between all nations, that they do not want war. But here we see that Krishna is not discouraging war. We have to mark this point. He is not discouraging war, but he is rather advocating, inducing Arjuna that, no, this is not defeating your position. You must fight. So, here is a point that sometimes we may do something which is approved by the general public, but it may not be approved by the Supreme Authority. Superficially, it may appear very appealing to the sentiment of the public, but factually, exact thing may not be correct. May not be correct. If we accept Krishna as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and why he was inducing Arjuna to fight, it does not mean that he was inducing Arjuna to do something wrong. But from worldly point of view, Arjuna was a very pious man, and he was declining to fight and not to kill his kinsmen, not to kill his friends. This is a very important point. So he argued, no, if I fight, my people will die, and their wives will become widow, and they will be adulterated, and then by adulteration, unwanted population will increase, and will offer and sadha, there is a ceremony of sadha according to Hindu scripture. I do not know whether you have in your Christian religion, but according to Hindu, a dead body is offered some respect every year. Just like death anniversary observed, similarly in the family, the descendants, they offer some foodstuff after some religious ceremony that is called sadha. And it is believed that offering goes to the dead forefathers. So that is a family religious ceremony. So Arjuna said that if these people will die, who will offer that evolution to the forefathers? So, from ordinary point of view, from the point of view of a family man, he argued with Krishna in so many ways. And after, at the end, he decided that I cannot fight. Then Krishna tried to induce him, and he said that yes, whatever you are saying, that I am a kshatriya and I am not doing my duty, this is all right. But my mind is perplexed. So he was at the same time conscious that Sri Krishna only can make a solution of this perplexity. So he said, katpanna dosupa satasthabhava prichyami tan dharma sangamura cita jatse vasan nishchitam buddhistanme shishastiham sadhimang tan pramanyam. Yes, katpanna dos. Katpanna dos means a miserly man. He was conscious of the fact that he was a great hero, he was a great fighter, and at the same time the enemies were there. So his actual duty was to fight with the enemy. They are offering fight. For a kshatriya, there are some obligations. If somebody challenges that I want to fight with you, a kshatriya cannot deny. If somebody challenges, yes, I want to bet with you, gambling, a kshatriya cannot deny. For that reason, the Pandavas lost their kingdom. The other side, his cousins, offered them that, all right, let us come to betting. So betting, the bit was, and they offered the kingdom. If you are defeated, then you lose your kingdom. So they lost their kingdom. Then the next offer was that if you are defeated, you lose your wife. So They lost their wife. And similarly, they are cooked. Now, this time if you are defeated, you have to go to the forest for 12 years. So, there was a great plan behind them, and the Pandavas were defeated in so many ways, and they were harassed and embarrassed for not less than 20 years. And now, they were to fight face to face. Now, he is not prepared to fight. That means he has become miserly. When he is deviating from his duty. Now, so he is concerned that practically I am deviating from my duty. Tatpanna dosa, this is my miserly behavior. Dosa means it is a fault on my part. I should not have deviated from this fighting, but my sentiment does not allow me to fight with my kinsmen. So here is a perplexity. So katpanna dosa apahata sabhava dharma sanghura seta. Not only I am miserly, but I am deviating from my duty, dharma. This dharma means, according to different positions, just like Brahman, the intellectual society, the Kshatriyas, the administrative society, the Vaishyas, the mercantile society, and the Sudras. Sudras means the laborer class. So these four divisions are always, now you can name in a different way, that doesn't matter. And in every society and for all time, these divisions are there. So, according to Vedic system, this system is observed by Janaka. So he was a Kshatriya. The Kshatriya's duty was to fight with the enemy, and he was not executing the injunction. Therefore, he is conscious that dharma sangamura teta, I am deviating from my religion also. It is the duty of Kshatriya. So, I am now perplexed. So, jat sreyasyat nishchita. Now, you should kindly, definitely say. Now, here is a position. I do not understand what is to be done. You kindly, jat sreyasyat nishchita. Nishchita means definitely. What is right, brihitanya. Now, Krishna can say, well, I am already telling you that you should fight, but you are not carrying out the order. So, he says, Sisakti Hang Sarimang Sang Prapannam. So, he accepted, all right, whatever arguments you have done so far, let us forget that. Now, I accept you as my spiritual master, not my friend. Now, the idea of accepting spiritual master, that is also very obligatory, you see. As soon as you accept one as a spiritual master, first of all, we have recorded in your heart that acceptance of spiritual master must be selected, you see, after careful examination. Just like one selects his bride or bridegroom, after careful examination, and in India, they are very careful because the marriage of the boys and girls takes place under the guidance of the parents. So the parents very carefully see. So similarly, one has to, the acceptance of spiritual master is necessary according to Vedic injunction, everyone should have a spiritual master. Perhaps you have seen a sacred thread we have got, sacred thread. That sacred thread is the sign that this person has his spiritual master. That's like, here of course there is no such distinction. A married girl, and according to Hindu system, they have got some sign. that so that people can understand this girl is married. They put on a red and I mean it's a painting here. So that others know that this girl is married. According to the division of the here, this parting is also, there is some meaning. When the parting is here in the middle, then that girl has her husband and she is coming from respectable family. And in the partition is here, then he sees a prostitute, you see. A prostitute cannot, there was king's ruling that a prostitute cannot pass here. And again, when a girl is well dressed, then it should be considered that she has got her husband at home. And when she is not well dressed, then it should be understood that her husband is out of home, you see. And a widow dress. There are so many, there are symptoms. So, similarly, this thread, sacred thread, is a sign that this person has accepted somebody as his spiritual master. He has got it just like this red mark symbolizes that this girl has her husband. Similarly, this sacred thread is the symbol that this man has got his spiritual master. So there is a ceremony, you see. So according to Vedic system, one has to accept a spiritual master in order to make a solution of his life. In every step of his life, the spiritual master guides. He also makes questions to the spiritual master and he guides, so that his life, his progress of life may be systematic. Now, to take such guidance means the spiritual master should also be a very perfect man. Otherwise, how can he guide? Now here, Arjuna knows that Sri Krishna is a perfect person. So therefore, he is accepting him as Sishyatiham Sadhimam Tam Prapannam. I am just surrendering unto you, he said. Yourself, and you accept me as your disciple, because friendly talk cannot make a solution of the perplexity. Friendly talk may be going on for years together, but there is no solution. Here, accepting Krishna as a spiritual master means whatever Krishna will decide, he has to accept. One cannot deny the order of a spiritual master. Therefore, one has to select a spiritual master whose order carrying he will not commit a mistake. Now, suppose if you accept a wrong person as spiritual master and if he guides you wrongly, then your whole life is spoiled. So one has to accept a spiritual master whose guidance will make his life perfect. That is the relation between spiritual master and disciple. It is not a formality. It is a great responsibility both for the disciple and for the spiritual master. And yes.
So if the disciple is in ignorance before,
yes,
how does he know which master to choose?
Doesn't have the knowledge. Yes. So the first thing is that one should be searching after a disciple, searching after a spiritual master. Now, just like you search after some school, you search after some school. So when you are searching after some school, you must have at least some preliminary knowledge what a school means. You cannot search after a school and go to a cloth shop. If you are so ignorant that you do not know what is a school, and what is a class of, then it is very difficult for you. You must know at least what is the school. Samsa guru meva avigachet and samitpani srotyam brahman. The spiritual master is required for a person who is inquisitive to have transcendental knowledge. He requires a spiritual master. You see? There is another verse in Srimad Bhagavatam. Tasmad gurum prapaddeta jigyasu shreya uttamam. Tasmad gurum prapaddeta. One should search after a spiritual master who is inquisitive about transcendental subject matter. So unless one is at least conversant with the preliminary knowledge of transcendental matter, that transcendental matter here you can see, Arjuna is perplexed. And now he wants a definite answer. This is the inquiry about transcendental subject matter. So every human being has to inquire. The inquiry must be there. What is that inquiry? That inquiry is that preliminary that every human being is suffering. Ignorant man, just like a cat and dog or an animal, they are suffering, but they do not understand. Just like we have seen, of course, here animals are slaughtered in slaughterhouse, according to Hindu system, of course, cow killing is not allowed. But there are meat eaters. According to Hindu system, only goats and lambs can be killed for meat eating. No other animals. Cow is not permitted. The Hindus, they do not eat cow's flesh. And the Muslims, they do not eat, hog's flesh, they do not eat. They have got some sentiment. But meat eating is also there in the Hindu society. But that is only by goat's meat or lamb's meat. Generally goat. Now, these goats are sacrificed before a goddess Kali. So I have seen it, that one animal is being killed, slaughtered, and another animal, which will be slaughtered next, it has been given some grass and it is standing there. It has no knowledge that my next term is mine. So it is not going out. So this is animal. This is that. A human being is not so fool. If there is sign that next time my killing is to be taken up, then at least he will protest or try to go away, something like that, you see. But there is no such thing. So the distinction between animal and man is that the animal is not aware of the suffering she is undergoing. There are suffering both for the animals and for the man. But man is conscious. If a man is not awakened to his suffering, then he is in animal conscious. We should not forget that we are always under suffering. There are three kinds of suffering. I don't say about this economic problem, or that is also another suffering, but according to basic knowledge, or it is a fact, there are three kinds of suffering. One kind of suffering belonging to the body and the mind. Now suppose I am getting some headache. Now I am feeling very warm. I am feeling very cold. So many bodily sufferings there are. Then similarly, we have got suffering from the mind. My mind is not well today, somebody has caused me something, so I am suffering, or I have lost something, some friends, so many things. So suffering from the body and mind, and then suffering by the nature. This is called adhidaivik, which we have no control. In every suffering we have no control, especially suppose there is heavy snowfall. The whole New York City is flooded with snow and you are all put into inconvenience. That is called a suffering, but you have no control. You cannot stop snow falling, you see. there is a wind, cold wind, you cannot stop it. This is called adhidaivik suffering. And the suffering of the mind, the suffering of the body is called adhyatmi. And there is other suffering, adhibhauti, attacked by other living beings. My enemy, some animal, or some worm, so many. So these three kinds of sufferings are there, all. All. But we do not want all these sufferings. When this question comes, now here, Arjuna is conscious that there is a fight, and it is my duty to fight with the enemy, but there is suffering because they are my kinsmen. So he is feeling that. So unless the human being is conscious and awakened to the fact that we are always in suffering, but we do not want all this suffering. This question, such a person is required to approach spiritual world. When he is conscious, you see. So long his animal life, that he does not know that he is always in suffering. He does not know, he does not care, or he does not want to make a solution. Here Arjuna is suffering, and he wants to make a solution, and therefore he accesses his spiritual mind. So when we are conscious of our suffering, we are awakened to the suffering situation. Suffering is there. Forgetfulness or ignorance of suffering is no meaning. Suffering is there. But when one is very serious to make a solution of his suffering, then a spiritual mind is required. That's why Arjuna requires now a spiritual mind. Is it clear?
Yes.
So, the suffering is there. It does not require any education. Simply a thinking, that a slight thinking, that I do not want all this suffering, but I am suffering. Why? Is there any solution? Is there any solution? All these scriptures, all this Vedic knowledge, everything, not only Vedic knowledge, now, why you are going to school, why you are going to college, why you are taking scientific education, why you are taking law education. Everything is meant for ending our suffering. If there was no suffering, then nobody would have taken education, is it? But he thinks that if I am educated, if I become a doctor, or if I become a lawyer, or if I become an engineer, I will be happy. That is the ultimate aim. I will get a good job, government job, I will be happy. The happiness is the end of every pursuance. So, these mitigation of suffering, they are temporary. Real suffering is due to our this material existence, these three kinds of suffering. When one is conscious about his suffering and he wants to make a solution of the suffering, then there is necessary of spiritual mind. Now, if you want to make a solution of your suffering and you want to consult a person, now what sort of person he must be who can end your all suffering? That selection must be there. If you want to purchase a jewel and a diamond and very valuable thing, and if you go to a grocer's shop, such kind of ignorance, you must be cheated. You must be cheated. At least you must approach a jewelry shop. Jewelry shop. You say, so much knowledge you must have. So, is that question found? Yes. The necessity of a spiritual master is for him who is conscious of his material suffering. If one is not conscious of his material suffering, then he is not even on the human being status. He is still in the animal status. Animal status, you see. Now, the modern civilization is practically, they are evading the real suffering. They are engaged in temporary suffering. But the Vedic system is Vedic knowledge. They are meant for ending the sufferings of, for good. Suffering for good. You see? The human life is meant for that, ending all suffering. Of course, we are trying to end all kinds of suffering. Our business, our occupation, our education, our advancement of knowledge, everything is meant for ending suffering. But that suffering is temporary. Temporary. But we have to end the suffering for good. Suffering. That sort of knowledge is called transcendental knowledge. And if anyone is seeking after that transcendental knowledge, this Bhagavad Gita is not an ordinary thing, it is transcendental knowledge. And now here, the ground is prepared. Ground is prepared. Arjuna is conscious of his suffering, perplexity. Now he is seeking a spiritual master. We should take the position of Arjuna, disciple. When a disciple is serious about making a solution of his suffering, then he requires a spiritual master. And what sort of spiritual master? Krishna, the most perfect man. The most perfect man. So, a spiritual master is representative of Krishna. Of course, Krishna is not present before us. But at least, we must have a person as our spiritual master who represents Krishna. And who can represent Krishna? One who is devotee of Krishna. In the line, disciple success. So, see here, Arjuna accepts Krishna as a spiritual master. Question may be that why Arjuna, there were many learned men, not only Krishna, but there were Vasudeva and other great sages and Brahmins. Why? Krishna was also Kshatriya. Krishna was not a Brahmin. Of course, he took his, he appeared in the family of a Kshatriya. And they were cousin brothers, Krishna and Arjuna, they were cousin brothers. Krishna was his son of the brother, and Arjuna was the son of the sister. Arjuna's mother and Krishna's father, they are brother and sister. So, they are in a family relation, they are intimately related, and at the same time they are of the same age and friends. Now, the question may be, why Krishna is accepted as a spiritual master? That is the selection of the disciples. That Arjuna says, Nahi prapasyami mamapunudya jachuka muchu sanamindriyanam avapa bhumava asapasnamidyam rajyam sudanam apichadipattam. Now, he says that I am so perplexed that my lamentation cannot be satisfied even if I get the kingdom of the universe. I am going to fight for the kingdom only of this earth or the India Of course, formally, India means Bharat. Now, India is a name given by the foreigners. The real name of this planet is Bharatvarsh. This planet. Now, gradually, it has been cut off. Just like we have got an immediate experience that some portion of India is now cut off and that is named Pakistan. You know all. Similarly, this whole planet, 5,000 years before, this whole planet was known as Bharatvarsh. Before that, thousands and millions of years before, this planet was known as Ilavati Varsh. And now, since the time of Emperor Bharat, there was an emperor whose name was Bharat. So, from the name of Bharat, this planet's name became Bharatvarsh. So, up to 5,000 years before, why 5,000 years before? Say, up to 4,000 years before, although the modern history cannot give account, chronological account, more than 2,500 years. But we are speaking about 4,000 years before, this planet was called Bharatvarsh. Now, Arjun says that we are going to fight for the matter of this Bharatvarsh planet. This is one of the planets in the universe. But if I get the whole planets of this, the complete planets of this universe, and without any competitor, is still the perplexity which has arisen in my mind. That cannot be mitigated. So, now see, what sort of responsibility is given to the Krishna. Sanjaya was. Sanjaya is saying, eva mukta rishikesam gurati suparantapaha nadasri ribuvindam mukta tushni vanubaha. Just saying this, Arjuna becomes silent. So I cannot fight. Samubhacha Rishikesaha prahasan niva bharata senaya rupan madhi visidantam vidangamasaha. Now here Krishna is addressed as Rishikesa. Rishikesa, we should always remember that Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. He is present as incarnation. Now, God is all-powerful. God is all-powerful. So, if He comes before you, you cannot deny that how is that God has come. You cannot say that. If God is all-powerful, then it is His choice, it is His free will. He can come before you, provided you are such qualified devotee. So, there cannot be any solid argument that God cannot come, or God, of course, so far Vedic literatures are concerned, they accept the incarnation of God. So Krishna is the Supreme Personality of God. And so he is addressed as Rishikesa. Rishikesa, it has got significant meaning. Rishik means a descendant. Rishik. And Isha means Lord. Isha means Lord. So He is the Lord of the senses. He is the Lord of the senses. Similarly, Govinda. Govinda. Here also, Govinda name is also there. Yes. Nadasya iti Govindam uktya tushning bahuvaha. Govinda. Govinda. Go means also senses. Go means calm. Go means land. And go means sense. And Inda means pleasure. One who gives pleasure to the cow, one who gives pleasure to the land, one who gives pleasure to the senses. His name is Govinda. Now two names are used here. So we should try to understand what is the meaning of Rishikesh. Rishik means Indriya and Isha means Lord. So whatever senses we have got, actually the proprietor of the senses, not myself. The proprietor of the senses is God. Just like we are sitting in this room is allotted for our sitting under some consideration of rent or whatever it may be, but this room is not ours. That's a fact. We should not consider that I am the proprietor of the room. Although I am using it to my heart's desire as I like, that is a different thing. But as soon as there is some misunderstanding, or the landlord says, now you cannot room in this room, vacate, I have to vacate. Similarly, this is also just like room, this our God. This body is given to us by God under certain conditions. And as soon as God likes that you should vacate from this body, I have to vacate. Nobody can allow us to stay here. And besides that, just like this hand, now suppose if this hand is paralyzed, the power of this hand is so long there is power from the Supreme. Otherwise, if my hand is paralyzed, there is no remedy, you see. So we are not the owner of this body, not the owner of the senses. The senses are just like hired from the Supreme Lord. This is a very subtle understanding, one should know. So therefore, actually, the proprietor of the senses is God. Now, if I am the proprietor of this tape record, then it should be utilized for my purpose. Anything which I own, that should be utilized for my purpose. Your things should be utilized for your purpose. So, if God is the proprietor of our senses, then these senses must be used for God's purpose. That is the constitutional position. Now, when these senses are used for other than God's purpose, that is our bondage, condition of life. When the senses are purified and it is used for God's purpose, that is natural life. So whole trouble is that although our senses and everything, whatever we have got, and there is Isho Upanishad, a part of Veda, it is stated there that Isha Avasanidam Sadman, everything, whatever you see, that belongs to God. Now, it is our misunderstanding that we are claiming, all the people of the world, they are claiming as proprietor. Now, just like this American land, now you are claiming as the proprietor. But is it a fact, actually, are you proprietor? Now, say, some hundreds and hundreds of years when Columbus came, so there were no Americans here. So you were not proprietor, the land was there. Now, when you shall go away, the land will also be there. So the land belongs to God and everything. Now, we say that we have manufactured this typewriter. Now this typewriter, ingredient, the iron, have we manufactured iron? No. Iron is received from the mine. It is given by God. Nobody can manufacture iron. Nobody can manufacture anything. They can transform from one thing to another. They can bring out the iron from the mine, they can melt and they can transform the shape of the metal in a different way. So that they can do, but they cannot produce iron. They cannot produce anything. Wood, iron, earth, anything, whatever. So the real proprietor is God. Real proprietor is God. Everything. Isa avasya nidana sarva. This is God consciousness. This is God consciousness. One who is in God consciousness, he is a perfect man. He is a perfect man. So here, the significant word, samvata rishikesa prahasan iva bharata sena rubhayan madhe visidantam idam vacha. Now, Krishna is smiling. Krishna is smiling because, just see, Arjuna is such a hero, he is my friend, and now he is so much pursuing. Now, when he sat down, and he and Arjuna accepted Krishna as a spiritual master, now Krishna begins to speak. See, Bhagavan was. See, Bhagavan was. Yet, the book does not say Krishna was. See, Bhagavan was. Now we should understand what is the meaning of Bhagavan. Bhaga means opulence. There are six kinds of opulence. So what are these opulences? Wealth is opulence. Then the strength is opulence. Then sadhyasya samakrasya bhidyasya strength and fame. Fame is also opulent. Just like Lord Jesus Christ. The whole Christian world knows. Lord Krishna. Everyone knows. Apart from that, President Johnson. Now the whole America and the whole world knows who is President Johnson. Mahatma Gandhi. The famous. So fame is also opulent. Just like your Rockefeller, they are very rich. Everyone knows in the world. So they are opulent by wealth. Similarly, somebody is opulent by fame. Somebody is opulent by strength. So strength is opulent. Wealth is opulent. And fame is opulent. And then beauty. Beauty is also opulent. If one man or woman is very beautiful, he attracts persons. He attracts. So anything that attracts that is called opulence. A wealthy man attracts. A strong man attracts. A famous man attracts. If somebody famous man comes here, so many people will gather to receive him. So these are opulences. Wealth, strength, fame, beauty, knowledge and renunciation. Six.